Hey guys, I'm Chris with Createx Colors, and I'm going to show you how to use our Quicksilver to spray this Silver Surfer.
Okay guys, we're here in the booth. We are ready to start step one of this entire process, and that is to make sure that our substrate is ready for paint. So we're going to do that. The bottom of this is a little hammered, so we did a little bit of body work to it to do some fine tuning. The top side isn't as bad, so we just did a little bit of body work to that, and we're going to go right to sealer, our Autoborn sealer on the top. But the bottom is going to need a little more attention, so I'm using a polyester primer. This is a high build surfacer, a little bit heavier, a lot heavier actually than our sealer, so we'll show you guys the difference. But once this is done, I'm going to do 3 coats over my body work and all over this, let that dry, and then I'm going to sand that, and then I'll do my Autoborn sealer to encapsulate everything. So we'll show you guys basically like any kind of step that you would have to take, whether it's over a surfacer or a direct to paint or any bare metal substrate. We'll kind of cover all that doing this project. So I'm going to go ahead and get my first coat of surfacer on right now. Hey guys, it is day 2, we are back in the booth. Remember yesterday, last night, we put some polyester primer on this. Came in this morning, blocked it all down, made sure it was nice. We had a couple little issues that we ended up doing a little more body filler on. So I did the filler on top of the polyester primer, got this to where I wanted, sanded it, actually finished sanding all this. This is around 320 DA, so it's ready for our Autoborn sealer. So if you remember, this side, it's pretty good. It looks worse than it is. We're gonna do sealer on this, and we're gonna do sealer over a polyester primer. So I got everything mixed up, and I'm ready to go. Hey guys, we're back in the booth. We're doing a little bit of Quicksilver on our Quicksilver Surfer. We have everything done in gloss white, so we used our sealer white, filled in a little body work, some imperfections that we had, and this is a catalyzed 2K gloss top coat over that. So the trick in applying the Quicksilver is it has to be a very shiny substrate and very clean in terms of imperfection. So because of the size of this project, we would have used the 4050, but we opted for a solvent base clear just because it's a lot easier to polish everything. We would have had to polish everything to get it that much better. So for this application, the 2K was a little bit better. So everything is completely clean, tacked off, polished exactly how we want it. I'm going to start my process of the Quicksilver Chrome, and before I do that, I want to just touch on gun selection and kind of a trial and error thing. This product is extremely easy to overapply. It is very thin in terms of viscosity. You see on the bottle it says do not reduce, it's sprayed right out of the bottle. So I tried a couple different guns. We did some test patterns and spraying and see what we liked and what we didn't like, what we thought would get us in the right spot, because there's so many pieces we want to be consistent. I opted for my W400, but it is not an LV tip. It's not an HVLP gun. It's what they would be like a conventional higher pressure gun. I'm going to be spraying right around 45 PSI. And my fluid control is almost all the way in. If you look, the trigger pull, that's it right there. That's my trigger pull. So it's a very small amount of paint to a larger amount of air. You want to put this on like guide coat, very dry, and really over atomize this product, because it's designed to build and it should be very transparent. It dries almost on contact. So we're probably going to do 3 to 4 coats to get us that look. We're doing it over white instead of black, only because black will give us more of that smoke chrome effect. We wanted a brighter chrome. So I'm going to stop talking and start spraying. I'll show you guys, this is coat number 1. Guys, we're back. Coat number 1 is dry. This is going to be coat number 2. And you can see how very fine this is. In that first coat, you see my hand motion and my hand speed and how I'm triggering the gun. It's very fast. It's kind of like a controlled chaos spray pattern. It's just enough of a fog to let that sit down but not get too wet where it will start to model. Because once this models, it's almost like candy. Once it starts to model, there's no going back. You're not going to be able to cover that up. So this is coat number 2. Okay, we're back again. Coat number 2 is dry. This is going to be coat number 3. Okay guys, we are back. This is the last piece for all the parts to put together. Save the best one for last. I have 1 coat on here already, and you can see it is very light. Again, I keep stressing, I keep talking about it in terms of how light your coats are. It is key to work in light coats. It's a lot easier to go and maybe put that last coat on if you don't like what you see, but it's a lot harder to take that off, so you'd have to start all over again. So the key to this is ample drying time. You know, again, we're in a booth, we have good air movement, humidity is under control, we have a lot of airflow, so we're giving it about 10 to 15 minutes between coats. Again, just like you want this to be totally dry. This product does, it is designed to dry on contact, but a couple extra minutes is not gonna hurt you. You're better off going with totally dry than having a risk of being too wet. And another thing is, once we're done with this, we're gonna let this sit. The longer this sits, the better it's gonna look. It actually, as these platelets, as this silver settles down and becomes a uniform finish, it'll actually increase in that reflective look. Like at first, it might just look like shiny silver, but as it dries, it's going to get more chrome-like. So we're gonna let this sit. We have the ability to bake, so we'll probably throw a bake on it, just a quick heat cycle to kind of expedite that process. But if you were doing it at home or you didn't have the ability, at least 24 hours, and you will see a huge difference. You'll know what I'm talking about. It actually does increase in that shine. So we're gonna do 2 more coats on here, and we're gonna let this really dry up, and then we're gonna put another 2 coats of 2K Solvent Clear over the top of that. So this is what coat number 2 looks like.
Welcome back. Everything is dry and we are about to start phase 4, the last step of this Quicksilver Surfer project. So you guys can see everything is really dry. I put all the last coats, the finish coats, we checked everything out, made sure that everything looks good and is even and the color is consistent throughout all the parts. We opted not to bake it and force dry it. We actually just let it sit. We really didn't have a super rush. So we let it sit. So it actually sat for 2 days. So 48 hours is a wonderful amount of time to let this product really sit down and come together. Those platelets, the chrome platelets, will actually level themselves out, and actually that's what we talked about. It gets brighter as it dries because everything acclimates and it takes on a completely different look than when you're actually spraying. So again, that's one of those things I wanted to touch on. If you're not happy with how it looks, or if you're like, oh man, I think if I put more on, what happens is when you start layering this product more, it'll still be bright, but it'll take on more of a really, really, really fine bright silver look rather than having that reflection of the chrome. So this was four coats on everything. I did one more drop coat, you know, real light mist coat to make sure everything was nice and even. So we got everything hung up. Everything is ready to go. We're gonna start clearing. We're gonna use a solvent-based, a 2K clear, PPG EC550. Love that clear. It's a water-based specific clear. So product works really well. And also, I want to touch on real quick before we move on, gun selection. If you remember, I ended up using a full-size spray gun. I used my my W400, which ends up being, like I said, a conventional higher air pressure spray gun, and the fluid control was turned way in, but I was able to still get a big fan, and that's for this project. It was key, I think, in terms of what we were trying to achieve. This is to date the biggest Quicksilver project that I've done. I've done a lot of stuff on smaller projects, but nothing this size where really the consistency and the repeatability is key. So we did a lot of spraying. We tried, I thought maybe the 80 was gonna be a good idea. We actually even played around with the TH2 quite a bit, which is an awesome gun. And I liked how it sprayed, but what happens is you have more passes, you know, on something this big. And every time you have to make another pass or go back because you think you missed something, you end up with inconsistency. So after we did a lot of testing, a lot of spraying, a lot of trial and error, I ended up deciding that this is gonna be the ticket. So because it's a larger project, you know, you can break this down and basically make this into like a pie and have six slices of this pie. So it's every time you saw it was just up and down really quick. So it actually just makes everything that much easier. So that's pretty much it for that in terms of gun selection. It's key. Maybe sometimes think outside the box in terms of the tools that you might have to get the job done. And the last thing too, real quick, I want to talk about is the tack rag. We talked about how crucial the surface is for this product. You know, you can see everything is highlighted, so any kind of dirt, any kind of dust is going to be magnified times 10. So for these and for most of our paint projects, I use these are water-based specific tack rags from Gerson. They're great. They're developed specifically for water-based paint. So again, just make sure, keep everything clean, tack everything off between coats, and you're ready to go. So these are already tacked. I'm gonna spray each one of these pieces individually with clear. We're gonna just work on like an assembly line. This way I can get around it, kind of the same way I did the parts in the video too, is give myself a little bit more room so I'm not right on top of everything. So we're gonna stop talking and we're gonna start spraying. So we'll see you guys in a little bit. All right, guys, we're back. I am ready for my second and final coat of clear on all the parts. Actually, all the other parts are all done. This has got one coat on it right now. It's just about at that stage where I'm ready to do a second. I was initially planning on doing three coats, but this came out really clean and there are no serious issues that I'm trying to bury. So two coats is gonna be where we leave it, you know, in terms of adding more material on and running the risk of maybe having a couple gravity indicators and some flow indicators on there. We're gonna leave it at two coats. So I just, again, wanna touch real quick. We're doing a solvent clear coat, a urethane clear coat, and I am using my Iwata Supernova. It's a 1.3. It's my clear gun for everything. I love this gun for spraying. So right around the same air pressure that they recommend, and 29 PSI in the gun. So it's great. I actually have it turned in a couple turns just because this is a little bit smaller, but fluid control is wide open. So I'm ready to go. I'm gonna start spraying my second coat. Okay guys, this is it, totally done and assembled, ready to go. If you remember, we opted to use our 4104 Quicksilver over white. Our sealer white was our base for this. We feel that the white gives it a little more chrome-like glow, a little brighter finish than putting over black. Black has a tendency to push it a little darker, a little smokier. So this is it, totally done with a couple coats of 2K urethane clear. Thanks for checking us out.